We do have some handouts on the table here. Suzanne informs me that nobody gets out of the room without taking a Traces magazine. So if you want to go home tonight, grab a magazine. And then I think she's got a couple of door prizes. We'll figure out how to avoid those a little later. And they're good. We're rolling right into our third program next week, which will be on a woman named Amaya Kushner. And y'all have never heard of her, I'm sure, because her family had not heard of her. They had, one of the family members had this little painted porcelain thing that Amaya had done. And so the woman that's speaking started doing a little research, and she uncovered this incredible treasure trove of information about this woman who looked like a Gibson girl, was very good at painting porcelain. She started out in Terre Haute. She had some family ties to Crawfordsville and went on to paint the crown heads of Europe, the Tsar and Tsarina, just Cecil Rhodes and Rhodesia, just all sorts of stuff. Looked like a Gibson girl, marketed herself, and made tons of money. It's just a fascinating story how this one little thing could open up this whole history. On somebody who was largely forgotten, even in her own family. So it's a great program. So look for that next Thursday. You can call us. You can sign up. We'd love to see you. Now, tonight, our program is going to look at your Indiana Historical Society and how it's collected Indiana history over the last 190-some years, which is amazing. It's got to be one of the oldest organizations in the state of Indiana. Things that have survived that long. It's got some stunning collections, and obviously the most stunning collection they have is from Montgomery County. no question. They have the Lew and Susan Wallace papers, and you know they've got, because of those, they've got the letters that Lew and Billy the Kid wrote back and forth. They've got the original sketches that Lew made of the Lincoln conspirators during the Lincoln assassination trial. So they've got some tremendous things, and that's just the Lew Wallace stuff. They've also got huge collections. Some that have come in recently are the Madam C.J. Walker collection. She's widely recognized as the first black millionaires. So earned her own money. Jean Stratton Porter, they got a tremendous collection on her. Just all sorts of neat things. So I don't know what she's going to talk about. But
you just, that was my lecture.
Suzanne is vice president of the Archives and Library. So if you have historical kind of questions, go to her. But I think she's going to talk about, you know, what the society has, how they've come across them, and to help us out a little bit of Lew Wallace, why you don't always take everything that's offered to you, and that's an important thing for museums to consider. And then also some of the current collecting initiatives. The Historical Society is very far-sighted, and they like to look down the road on what our future generation is going to need. And she does have some handouts for some of the things that they're seriously looking at right now as far as collecting initiatives. There is going to be tomorrow kind of a follow-up, a part B to this, and that is a behind-the-scenes tour of the Historical Society. We have a few slots left, so if anybody would like to sign up for those, we've got the sign-up sheet, and let me know. We'll give you the details on how to go ahead and attend that tomorrow. So without any further ado,
thanks, Larry. And thank you all for coming this evening and learning a little bit more about IHS. Let me know if that works. So I thought before we kind of got into the collections part, we'd give a little overview of what the Indiana Historical Society is. So as Larry mentioned, we were founded in 1830, so we are one of the oldest historical societies in the country. We are also one of the oldest organizations in Indiana. Most state historical societies, though, are a state agency, and we're a little different in that we're not a state agency. We are actually a private nonprofit organization. And although we're not a state agency, we definitely have statewide outreach. We've got a beautiful building. Hopefully you can all join us tomorrow in downtown Indianapolis, but we are certainly statewide in our collecting and in our outreach activities as well. So our mission, a couple of different things going on here. So we collect, we preserve, and we share Indiana stories. And we share those stories in several different ways. We do a lot of exhibits, both in our building, but also traveling exhibits throughout the state. We do programming both virtual and on site. We do publications like Traces, and you really do need to take some Traces on your way out. And we also do a lot of web content. We are getting ready to launch our own web channel that's going to have podcasts and web series and online exhibits, so be on the lookout for that coming soon. But all of the different ways that we share these stories start with the collection, because if you don't have the documentation, you can't tell the stories. And so that's why it's important for us to have a well-rounded and solid collection. So let's dig a little deeper into the collection. I'm going to throw a lot of numbers at you here. We are one of the largest collections that document the history of Indiana and the Old Northwest. We're a paper-based collection, so that's a lot of books, a lot of maps, a lot of photographs, and manuscript collections. So for us, a manuscript collection is anything that's not formally published. So your diaries, your letters, your business records, that type of information. I had a colleague one time somehow calculated that if you put everything we had on top of each other, it would be almost 8 miles high. We've never tried that, but you get the picture. We've got a lot of stuff, and we've got some really great stuff that illustrates and documents Indiana's history. So how did this all start? Well, even though we were founded in 1830, our collection as we know it today kind of started around 1922 by a gentleman named Delavan Smith. He gave us his father's, William Henry Smith was his father's name, collection of rare books and documents. Fantastic collection. Not necessarily Indiana related though. It was mainly just rare books, really cool items, but there wasn't necessarily that Indiana connection. We also started collecting papers and documents of really prominent men early on in Indiana's history. So you see names like William Henry Harrison, Lew Wallace, Benjamin Harrison, and we've really accumulated strong collections on some of these early leaders and figures in the state's history. We also at that time focused on kind of pre-statehood into a little past the Civil War time period. We weren't collecting much past the 1870s, 1880s, early on. That started to change though in the last 50 years. In the last 50 years, we're definitely only collecting Indiana related. It's gotta have an Indiana story or Indiana connection somehow. We're collecting more in the 20th century, as well as even the 21st, and we'll talk about a recent, very recent, contemporary collection. We emphasize collecting items that more fully document the experiences of all Hoosiers. We are constantly looking at our collection, and if there's a gap in the historic record, we're going to be very proactive to fill that gap. And Larry mentioned some of the collecting initiatives. Late 1970s, we started a women's history collecting initiative. 1980s, we were going to focus on African American history. We work with the Indiana Jewish Historical Society to collect items relating to Jewish history in Indiana. We've launched an LGBTQ collecting initiative, and recently a Latino and Asian American collecting initiative. It's important that we have a collection that represents all Hoosiers. And so we really strive to make sure that the collection fully documents as many voices and as many perspectives as possible in the state. And then the last one, and you probably noticed this too, we're getting more and more born digital items. That could be a whole other presentation of how you deal with those. About 5 years ago, we actually had a hard drive donated to us. And it wasn't as an artifact. That had all of this individual's information on it. Word documents, scary AOL emails. All of the photos weren't prints. They were digital photographs. So how do you preserve that? How do you share that? And I think that's something we're going to see more and more in the future, how to make that type of material accessible. So how do we get all of this great stuff? Most of it is through donations. People kindly give us their personal and professional papers, their family papers, These are all personal collections or private entities that are donating materials to us. We also have an acquisitions budget, so we can look at auctions, we can look at dealers. Sometimes individuals, they don't want to donate to us. Obviously, that's our preference, but sometimes they want to sell to us, so we'll work with them to purchase items. And then there's a couple other different ways as well that we kind of gather the materials that we collect. All of this, though, we are guided through our collections management policy, which outlines all aspects of collections care and collections management. And so that really is our guide that we need to stick to. And it's about an 8-page document that kind of outlines everything that we should be doing. We also rely on two different bodies of people. We've got the IHS Collections Committee, which Larry kindly joins us several times a year, and that's made up of individuals throughout the state. And they, look at what we're collecting. They ask questions. They give us input and oversight. And then overall, IHS has a board of trustees, and that's the governing body of IHS. So they are ultimately responsible for the collection as well. So we've got several different places that give us input, give us oversight, and advice on the collection. So how do you decide? I will say daily, we have people coming wanting to donate materials to us. We can't take everything. It's a big building. It's not big enough to take everything that's offered to us. And frankly, not everything that's offered to us is the best fit. So we have a series of criteria that we look at to help judge whether or not it makes sense for us to take that material. We're going to look at the story. What type of story is this documenting? Is it giving a different perspective, perhaps, than what we have? Is it a different geographic location in the state? Is it a different time period, a different voice? So we're always looking at what story is this item telling. We look at research value. So we are ultimately a research library. We use our collection for our items, but we also open it up that anyone can come and research in our facility. And so I know this is going to sound bad, we track what people research because we want to make sure we're collecting things that are going to be useful to researchers, not only now, but in the future as well. We definitely look at condition. Sometimes people bring us things that were stored in the attic or the basement, and there's mold or there's critters. And we don't really want that, so we certainly look at condition, format and size as well. We want to make our collection available. So if something comes to us with a lot of usage restrictions, we're going to take a close look at that, because if we can't share it with people, it doesn't make sense for us to collect that in most cases. Duplication. We archive one copy of every item in most cases. So if we already have it, we're not going to take a second copy. If the Indiana State Library, which is right across the corner, already has it, we're probably not going to take it either. Or if another institution has an incredible collection that's digitized, easy to get to, easy to see, then that's probably something we're not going to take as well. So we're always trying to make sure we want it to be covered, but if someone else is already doing it, we don't need to be the ones to do that as well. And then the last one is provenance. We need to make sure that whoever's giving us the material has the right to give us that material. Sometimes people will find things at yard sales, and sometimes, yes, we'll take those. But again, we need to make sure that there aren't any restrictions or possible copyright issues that we need to be aware of when that's given to us. So when someone donates something, we actually have a legal document, a deed of gift, that formally transfers that material to us. So they sign it, and we get not only the physical rights, but also any other rights as well. So copyrights transferred if they have it, and any other rights that might be connected with that material. I thought we would spend a lot of the time remaining just looking at highlights from the collection. And so people are always asking, what are your favorite things? I've been at IHS for 22 years now. In the interest of time, I won't share my gazillions of favorite things because there's so many. You know, we're always getting new items. I'm always discovering things that have been there that I have just never used before. And then I'll always think, like, oh, there was something I saw 10 years ago. Oh, that's my new favorite thing again. So there's so many great things, but I wanted just to kind of give you a couple of highlights. And Larry, you're really good. You got a lot of the ones that I was going to talk about here. So he mentioned the Madam Walker collection. This is actually our most requested collection. Most people are probably familiar with Madam Walker's story. There's been books. There was a crazy Netflix series that wasn't quite accurate in some places. There's even now a Madam Walker Barbie. If you are interested in that, make sure you check that out. But we were fortunate enough to acquire the business records and some of the personal records of Madam Walker. So Walker came to Indianapolis in 1910, established the Walker Manufacturing Company, and specialized in hair care products, beauty products, and had agents that would then sell these products throughout the country. Really, it was a worldwide company. When she died, it was believed that she was the first Black female millionaire in the United States. She was involved in philanthropy. She was involved in civil rights. Obviously, incredibly savvy businesswoman. So much was in her life that there's so many angles that people can use this collection for.
I was going to say right now, the National Trust is trying to find a way to preserve her estate on the Hudson River Valley.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful home that she had built, this Black lady amongst all the rich white people in New York. She was not shy.
Yeah. And we have the drawings to that if you ever want to come and see that. Yeah. So just a great collection. We got a grant a couple of years ago that we were actually able to digitize this collection. So it is now available on our digital collection. So anyone, anywhere can hop online and see all of this great stuff. So the next one's not really a collection. It's more of a format. I will admit, I'm a map geek. I think they are incredibly informative. And I think also they're works of art. And we've got, if you're into maps, we've got some amazing maps in our collection. So the oldest item that we have dates 1540. It's the item up there, the Sebastian Munster map. The item there is the Northwest Territory. This is believed to be the first map that has the word Indiana in it. Now it's the Indiana Territory at that point in time, but they think that's the first time that Indiana was on a map. And then you've got the Eagle map, which is actually a map of the United States, but it's in the shape of an eagle. So again, just a gorgeous, gorgeous map. And it kind of relates to what was happening during that time. You know, there was westward expansion, there was a lot of patriotism. So you've got the eagle with the wings and the talons. And so it symbolizes a lot of what the country was going through that time. All right, let's talk a little Lew Wallace. Yes, I've got a crowd here for that. So like Larry said, we do have an extensive Lew Wallace collection of papers. We acquired those in the 1940s and 50s, and it has correspondence, it has speeches, it has just a wide variety of items from Lew, from Susan, and from the family as well. A couple of the highlights, again, a lot of the ones that you mentioned. So the sketch, he was part of the conspirators trial for Abraham Lincoln. And so he sketched all of the conspirators who were on trial, except for he did not sketch her, but everyone else sketched of. And so that's, you know, how you have courtroom sketches. That's what Lew was doing for that time. He sketched all of the conspirators. The item there to the right is one of several letters between Lew Wallace and William Bonney, aka Billy the Kid. I have to say we get a lot of researchers for those, and they are very, very passionate, diehard researchers of the Billy the Kid letters. Either on one side or the other, but there's no middle ground for them. That's they get into to that.
Is there a 50-50 split or a 70-25?
You know, it has been kind of 50-50,
okay,
to tell you the truth. Yeah, yeah, it has. But yeah, there's definitely no middle ground on that one. And there in the middle, this actually wasn't part of the collections that we acquired in the 40s and 50s. I think it's like 1970s, 1980s. We decided we're going to try to accumulate a copy of every Lew Wallace letter or item in the country. And so we had a gentleman who either wrote and got copies or he traveled across the country. And so we put all of those on microfilm. Not a lot of use of microfilm these days. So a couple of years ago, we digitized everything on the microfilm. And so now you can search all of that on the digital collection as well. So sometimes one item can tell just such a broader story. We got this photograph from a relative, from the gentleman on the left there, Red Carnes, but it's probably the gentleman on the other side that you're gonna recognize. That is Joe Lewis, who was the heavyweight boxing champion of the world. This image is dated 1939, and so he was heavyweight champion at that point in time. And Joe Lewis went to West Baden and French Lick quite a bit during his career. He went there for training, he went there for vacation, and spent a lot of time there. He wasn't allowed to stay at either West Baden or French Lick because he was black. They would let him train and have exhibitions there, but they wouldn't let him stay there. So there was one hotel that he could stay at in town. It was called the Wadi, and that's where he stayed. But during this time, he was able to, you know, really get to know a lot of the townspeople and become friends with them. And so Red Carnes and he became friends. In fact, Red was a local boxer and actually volunteered to spar with Joe Lewis several times. And so this was a photograph that he had kept in his collection, and then his family wanted to make sure it got preserved and donated it to us. We work with a lot of organizations from throughout the state. And it's always such a great feeling when an organization comes to you and trusts you to be the home to their archives. And so this is one of our latest organizations that we've been working with, is the Japanese American Citizen League Collection. And we have their papers, their photographs, their membership information, and we preserve that, and we make sure that that gets shared. So a lot of these organizations are still very much active. And so about every 5 years, they'll gather all of their stuff and give us a new edition. And so these collections just continue to grow as the organizations continue to be active. So a lot of states claim Abraham Lincoln. But we had him in his formative years. That's what we like to say. You know, Abe learned to be Abe in Indiana. And so we can take pride in that. Unfortunately, though, there's not a lot that exists from his time in Indiana. You know, most of it, he's in Springfield or he's president. That's where you get the bulk of Abraham Lincoln materials. We have one item that he actually, his handwriting while he was living in Indiana, and this is it. And you want to talk about goosebumps. Try holding this document and looking and being that close to a math page that Abraham Lincoln was writing on. I mean, it just kind of gives you chills to think that you have and are so close to this item. So it's a one sheet. This is the front and the back. And it was from his sum book page. Now, obviously there was a lot of pages of this, but many, 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 many years ago, someone tore out all the pages, and so different places have copies of just the one page. And right now, there's only 10 that that are still known to be in existence. There could be others in private collections, but there's 10 from this book, and we have one of them. I've never tried to do the arithmetic. It looks pretty scary. But this is his handwriting while he was here. So another collection that gives you goosebumps, at least me, the David Bean papers. David Bean was from Owen County and had gone to law school, just graduated law school, was getting ready to start his practice. Civil War breaks out. So he becomes an officer, actually gathers a company of Owen County residents, and they form a company. And we love David Bean because he wrote his wife daily. And he wrote his wife in beautiful penmanship, very descriptive letters, details. It's a great collection. But when you go through the collection, you might notice the letter here, and you're probably saying, Suzanne, that's beautiful penmanship. And there's such a difference between this letter and all the other letters in the collection. You know, this letter, you can tell there's a little bit of shakiness with the handwriting. It's cramped. Well, if you look at the date, this was literally right after the Battle of Gettysburg, where he fought every day in the Battle of Gettysburg. And it gives an incredible firsthand account of what happened at that battle. He talks about how they made a V formation. He talks about how the Confederate troops were trying to go on this side, trying to go on that side. He talks about being next to people who were killed that he knew. He gives so many incredible details about probably one of the most important battles in American history. And it's all here in this letter. And this was before censors, you know, started removing things from letters. Because they probably would have cut out quite a bit from this letter, because he gives so many details of what happened during Gettysburg. When you read it, I've actually had people who, when they read this letter, start crying. It's that powerful. And so it's incredible to make this available, because you can read a lot of, you know, published works about Gettysburg, but when you read something from someone who was there, it's completely different. Completely different. We did a You Are There, which is where we take interpreters and they become, they're actors, and they become people from a picture or from an item. And we actually had them portray David Bean and narrating this letter, and people were just mesmerized just by hearing it. So I mentioned we're doing more contemporary collecting. Obviously, this is very contemporary. So in March, when COVID first started, was that 2020? It seems so. 2020, we knew this is something we need to document. You know, this is going to impact everyone, the entire state, every age, everyone. We didn't want to wait, you know, 20, 30 years down the road for people to then start giving us stuff. We wanted to document it now. So we tried something a little different, something we had never done before. We actually started a web portal. So on our website, people could come in, they could fill out a form, and then upload their submissions. And we weren't quite sure how it was going to go. We started this, I think we were actually the first in the country to start collecting documents related to COVID-19. The response was really incredible. We had over 600 submissions from people across the state. They sent us photographs. They sent us songs that they wrote. They sent us poems, artwork. So many different expressions of what they were feeling and going through at the time. A lot of teachers had their classes write down their feelings and sent those to us. We had, you know, healthcare providers. We had people in all forms of different businesses and how they were having to kind of change their focus in business to adapt. just so many different experiences that were documented. And so now we have this. And so when people start researching this, they're going to know that they can come here and we've got something that we are going to preserve. You know, so many people compare it to the 1918 influenza epidemic. We've got some things on that, but we realized there wasn't enough documentation on that. We wanted to make sure that we were going to have enough documentation. It's still open, by the way, if anyone wants to upload anything to the portal. So this collection is completely unique for us. It's really fascinating. So Nellie Simmons Meyer and her husband lived in a house called Tuckaway. It was located in Indianapolis. And they had a lot of famous friends who would stop by. They had amazing dinner parties, amazing get-togethers. But really, people were coming to Tuckaway because of Nellie's profession. Nellie was a palmstress. And so, people from all over the country either came specifically to see Nellie, or if they were traveling through Indianapolis, made it a point to go to Tuckaway and get their palms read by Nellie Meyer. And it's a who's who list. And so this collection has all of the palm imprints, and that's Walt Disney's palm. I expect a little mouse ears. So that's Walt Disney's palm print, and she was very scientific. For her, this was a science. This wasn't some sideshow thing that she. This was very much a science for her, and so she would have them do a palm impression. She would take that, she would study it, and then she would develop a 3-4 page narrative of what her findings were based on that palm print, and so she would send that to them. She was incredibly savvy because she also said, before I send this to you, can you send me a picture of yourself? So I have, that visual face that I can put with the palm. So this collection includes the palm print, the narrative, all of these photographs autographed by people like Walt Disney, and then a lot of correspondence back and forth between her and these individuals. Of course, that is Carol Lombard, Hoosier. She and Nellie were very close. And in fact, the collection doesn't verify it, but there is, according to the family, Carol went to Nellie's before she got on the plane where she died. And Nellie had told her not to get on the plane, that Nellie had a feeling. And of course, she did, and she perished in that plane crash after being here in Indianapolis for a warm on drive.
And Carol's still there at Tuckaway, by the way. Yeah.
Have you been to Tuckaway?
Oh, yeah.
It's a great.
It's a stunning place.
It is. It is. And they've kept the house. It's, in different hands now, but they've kept the house almost as is with the period furniture and everything. So this is a really interesting, unique collection for us. Okay, so I'm going to end with an item that always brings a smile to my face. And you're probably saying, Suzanne, why does a World War II letter bring a smile to your face? Well, this is a letter from Lieutenant Dora to his young brother, Jimmy, who lived in Vincennes. And we get a lot of World War II letters, and so we always look at them for the content. We want to make sure the content is strong, it's good, it's descriptive. But you might notice, I mentioned the censor, you might notice there's a censor stamp right here in the corner. Well, this was a very overzealous censor, because this is the letter that actually made it back to the family. So basically, you have Dear Jimmy, and then you've got a big old cutout spot, Love, Dick. But the best part, though, is, and I've blown it up there inside, the censor actually left a note, and it says, your brother is well and happy, but he talks too much. So the censor. There's nothing there, but the story is so actually presented this with another, and someone actually knew this family.
Oh,
and
awesome.
They got, well, he did talk a lot. So we would love to see you. We would love for you to use our collection. We are free. We are, anyone can access us. Parking's even free, and parking is easy because I know in Indianapolis parking can just be a pain. We've got an open lot that you can come and park for free. Come and use the library for free. We are open Tuesday through Saturday from 10 until 5. The only thing we ask is if you let us know that you're coming so we can get an appointment for you. And we'll work with you to help pull the things and get things ready for you. A couple of links I wanted to mention. Our website is incredibly easy to remember. It's just indianahistory.org. From there, you can find our online catalog. So that is the most comprehensive way that you can search our collection. Our collection are closed stacks. So basically, you tell us what you want to see. We bring materials down for you to take a look at. It's not where you can just browse the shelves. You've got to use the online catalog. Tell us what you want, and then we'll have it ready for you to take a look at. And then I mentioned a couple times our digital collection. We have over 100,000 items that we have scanned and that you can view anywhere you can get online. So if you're interested in Madam Walker, you can view that. If you're interested in sheet music, we've got sheet music, a lot of those maps. So there's just a lot of great content that we already have. So if you don't want to come to Indianapolis, you can hang out at home and just look at the digital collections there as well. So I have thrown an awful lot at you. Any questions?
They do have some great images of Montgomery County. It's a fun thing just to bring it up and scroll through. If you're from another part of the state, just bring up your county and see what they've got. It's a lot of fun. What happened to the Civil War soldier after the war?
He survived. He survived, and they lived in a beautiful home that actually is still standing in Spencer, Indiana. He lived quite a bit.
The brick was the tower that was in this, was it?
I think so.
Okay, I love that.
Yeah, I think so.
Can you take tours of Tuckaway?
I don't believe the current owner is opening it up for tours. You might keep an eye on Indiana Landmarks because they worked a lot with the house and they occasionally will offer a tour. But yeah, if you ever see one, it's a fascinating place. Yeah.
Suzanne, what's your process? So if somebody brings you something that they want to donate, do you in order to do your research, do you keep it for a while and then have them come get what you don't want? Like, how does that work?
Yeah, so we do. And it's a long conversation. So please don't ever just take something and drop it off and run, because we do have people, we call it a dump and run, who will bring us the scary looking box, give it to the welcome desk, and then we never ever. So please don't do that. So usually it's a conversation that we have. They reach out to us and we try to get information, and then we schedule an appointment and go through it with them, ideally, because that way they can give us who these people are, what the stories are, what information they have. And sometimes they'll leave it and we'll go through it more, and then they'll come back and pick up items that aren't going to be part of the collection.
Thank you for this presentation.
Sure.
I'm the archivist at Wabash College, so we have a lot of collections that were cross-pollinated.
Sure.
So that's kind of the crux of my question is, because you're collecting for the whole state, do you ever get collections where you say, well, that actually should be better off at some other institution, or if you are collecting that, then how do you make that material available to other institutions better fit for it, or actually it's more natural?
Oh yeah, we do a lot of referrals, and sometimes that's based on, if it's a lot of local history or maybe Yeah, we will refer people a lot. And if it's something that we have that maybe another institution wants to use for an exhibit, we do loan items. You know, we've worked a lot with Larry and the folks here to borrow items for exhibits or programs. We also provide scans. So if there's something that you see on the digital collection, you can download a low res, or you can come through us and if you need a high res for like a publication or anything like that. So yeah, it's definitely a partnership really with all of us, because none of us have the space to collect everything. You know, I mean, you know that. So yeah, you've got to work together to find the best home for something. Yeah. Ooh, are we ready for the big door prize giveaway? Oh, another prize, yeah.
What are you currently like most interested in gaining? Like, what is there a county you're most interested in getting, or is there a timeline, an era?
So we recently launched the Latino and also Asian American collecting initiatives, because we have very little that document those communities in our collection. So we've got a multicultural curator who is working a lot with oral histories, and we're trying to build up that collection. You know, as far as counties, because of our location, we've got a lot of Marion County, mm-hmm. so we're really looking for some other areas of the state that we might not be as strong in. But then again, we also work a lot with the local historical societies there as well. So, you know, if they have a strong collection already on a topic, then, you know, we'll refer folks to that local historical society too.
Yes. My name's Alan White. I'm from Yachtsville. I own the Yachtsville Old Mill and the boarding house.
Okay. Yeah.
And my question is, we're unsure how to safeguard the place, you might say. What steps should we take in our declining years to be sure that this property is continuing?
So if it's land and property and structures and buildings,
yes.
Indiana Landmarks is a great resource. So they're separate from us, but I can certainly get you their contact.
Well,
I'm not sure if they have a regional office here in Crawfordsville.
It's out of
Terre Haute.
Yeah,
okay.
Yes, we're connected. I mean, my son works for them.
Oh, good. Okay.
We have connections there.
Now, if there are, you know, papers, documents, photographs, you know, right now make sure those are stored in a dry, constant kind of temperature and humidity. You don't want a lot of fluctuation. If you're trying to store your records, you know, make sure there's no water, make sure there's, you know, plenty of, or little light as well. To safeguard any kind of collections that you might have.
A lot of times they'll get people bringing things in a sort of mixed bag. There's three-dimensional objects as well as archival stuff, and IHS will often, you have a cooperative arrangement with the Indiana State Museum, so the three-dimensional things tend to go to the State Museum,
yes.
and they keep the paper documents.
Yes. Good point, yeah.
Several years ago when they started the Latino thing, I found a little 2-inch by 3-inch photograph that my dad had in the 1930s of some Mexican Hispanic musicians. Don't know anything. I didn't know very much about them. My dad was from Lake County. And so I gave it to them, and happily they accessioned it, which lightened the load of stuff at my house. But they are so talented, they went in and they were able to find out who these guys were, why they were in Lake City. They were traveling Mexican mariachi men in a car, and they would just travel wherever the migrant workers were and would entertain them. And so this fabulous story came from basically nothing but a photograph for our family. So to me, it was just astounding.
So our courthouses are all going digital and everything. Have you ever been in any of those old courthouses?
With all of the volumes and ledgers.
Oh,
and
so cool.
Yeah.
What are they going to do with all that?
No, because, no. Those would go probably to the state archives since they're technically official county records. But hopefully they will be digitized, that people can search them easily.
They're so much better in real life.
Yeah, they are.
Stinky, but cool.
They are. And that's one of the great things about this collection and so many collections out there. To be able to handle the items is just a whole other experience. Like, if you're just needing the information, boy, it's easy to jump online and get it. But to have it's an experience to actually hold a Civil War diary that the soldier carried. I mean, it is kind of that extra layer to it. Yeah.
If you have not been to the Historical Society, they also have some great programming things. You are there, kinds of exhibits. Eva Core
is up, yep.
You'll get goosebumps if you go to the Eva Core thing. She is a holographic three-dimensional image. You can ask her anything you wish to ask her about the Holocaust, and she will answer your questions. It is a stunning bit of technology, and after you're in there for about 2 seconds, you forget that she passed away several years ago, because she is as live as you can imagine. It's really stunning. And they have this whole Porter room to solve. They've got music going. Whatever Cole Porter song you like, the performers will be able to bring it up for you and sing and play it. So there's a lot of fun stuff that goes on in the society.
Our next You Are There is going to be on Chuck Taylor. Everyone know Chuck Taylor? Of Converse shoes. Chuck Taylor was a Hoosier. We got a pair of Chuck Taylor. Well, I think if you wear those, you might get a discount one day. So look for that next year.
One of the URLs that I took my son to was with Robert Kennedy when he was talking on the night that Martin Luther King was shot.
Oh, wow.
And again, that was another thing where you just get tears in your eyes because it was so real. It was so three-dimensional.
Door prizes?
Let's do a door
prize.
Suzanne, I did want to just point out, I had to check, and it is the Beam House that I was thinking of. Indiana Landmarks is currently selling it for $889,000. So anybody who's got some pocket change, you can buy it.
There you go. It's a great story.
It's a beautiful house.
Yes. Oh, that's funny. Yeah. Am I okay to take this up to do the door prize?
We can do the door prizes, not
okay.
Sorry, Facebook, you don't get to.